I am going to make great deals for our country.
I mean, what I do is I do deals. I deal.
I negotiate by creating leverage so I can extract a good deal for the United States, for the people.
I make deals. I negotiate.
Everybody wants me to negotiate. That's what I'm known as a negotiator.
Well, maybe not on health care, at least not quite yet. President Trump learned this week that not even his larger-than-life personality can move his own party when they are stuck and they're very, very divided, especially when it's an issue like this where they have made promises over and over again to repeal Obamacare. They've done it for 7 years. Joining me now to talk about this is Democratic Congresswoman Debbie Dingell, former Republican presidential candidate and Senator Rick Santorum, CNN political commentator Bakari Sellers, and Republican Congressman Lee Zeldin. And Republican Congressman, because you are the Republican in the House where all of this fell apart this week, you get to start. I make deals. What happened?
The president worked really hard on trying to build a broader coalition and get additional people towards yes on this proposal he was supporting. I believe he had over half of the conference over to the White House. Yeah. He was making phone calls. The vice president was working on it. Mm-hmm. His team was working on it. And I think that he's going to learn an awful lot from this experience. I mean, it's...
What should he learn from it?
Well, you know, there's a lot more to do. And as you're talking about tax reform, infrastructure, strengthening our military, taking care of our veterans, going through the appropriations process in a four-year term, you learn lessons early on. I think maybe, you know, he learned from his first executive order related to the travel restriction, where the second one was a better rollout than the first one. You build relationships, you get a better scouting report on, you know, maybe one member is interested in, a tougher approach where someone else maybe doesn't want to be threatened.
I think more than one member, that was the problem. Senator, I was talking to a senior administration official who said it didn't matter what the policy was. They didn't want a deal, they meaning the House Freedom Caucus, and that the White House and the president himself was a captive in an internal House fight. You agree with that?
No, I don't. I mean, it always comes down to policy. I mean, the idea that that people are just recalcitrant and don't want to do anything for the sake of not doing anything, that's just not true. I mean, the Freedom Caucus had a vision of what they wanted to do, and they didn't want to keep the federal government in control. I mean, that's really the bottom line. They didn't want the federal government in control.
So you think they were right to torpedo this?
I've said for now a couple of months that the approach should have been a more conservative approach, which was to basically just turn this all over to the states and get the federal government out of the healthcare business. I think that's what really the Freedom Caucus wanted. Mm-hmm. And I think had the House started there, had Ryan started with a bill that included the study committee and the Freedom Caucus and the conservative bloc, which is your biggest block of votes, then you reach out to the middle to try to move the bill. But at least you've got the folks on board to start. And Paul Ryan took a different approach. He took an approach that no other conservative leader in the House has taken before, which is to start more with the middle to try to appeal to moderates and get a bill that can pass the Senate. And it just didn't work.
So, Congresswoman, from the Democratic side, you know, it is true that the Democrats, they planted their feet and they said, we are not going to be involved in anything that has to do with repealing Obamacare. Now that ship has sailed, will Democrats work with Republicans on at least fixing the problems that even you acknowledge are there?
You know, I said yesterday, I'll work with anybody to make it better, but I won't support a bad bill. This was a bad bill. This bill ripped.
Yeah, of course you weren't going to support this, but let's look forward.
I think we've got to see what they're willing to talk about. You cannot rip insurance away from people. You cannot force people to pay more and give them less. And at the end, they ripped away essential services. There are things that we can talk about. We need to do away with the Cadillac tax. We need to do something about prescription drugs, negotiate prices for Part D and Medicare. If you're willing to talk about things that don't hurt American people, we should be willing to sit.
But Bakari, is the Democratic base so fired up and they're demanding that Democrats like the Congresswoman and all of her colleagues don't talk to a Republican right now? Is that even going to be possible?
But that's not the demand. I think that is.
A lot of them are.
No, that may be the perception. But one thing that we did see, we saw House leadership take a step back, House Democratic leadership take a step back, and we saw the grassroots lead on this movement. Mm-hmm. You saw congresspersons getting inundated with phone calls, thousands and thousands of phone calls. I actually applaud Congresswoman Dingell for sitting here and saying that she's willing to work with Donald Trump and the Republicans to fix the Affordable Care Act. We all know that premiums are rising and we need to do something about that. We need to focus on the Republican part of the plan where they were going to invest $100 billion over 9 years to help stabilize the markets. These are things that we can do together. The Democratic base is appreciative for how far Obamacare has gotten us, but they also understand that we have to reform it so we can take it further.
Okay, I want to turn to another event that happened this weekend, kind of only happens in the Trump years. The president sent out a tweet, a promo for his friend on Fox News, Jeanine Pirro, saying watch the show. Then you turn on the TV, if you did, and here's what Jeanine Pirro said at the beginning of her show.
Ryan needs to step down as Speaker of the House. The reason? He failed to deliver the votes on his health care bill.
Again, Congressman, since you're the Republican in the House here, I want to ask you, and as I do, I just want to say that I am told by a source familiar with the backstory that he didn't know, he, the president, didn't know that she was going to call for him to step down. But the fact is that he told his viewers to watch somebody call for him to go.
The president and Speaker Ryan and the chief of staff, the vice president, I mean, these are really strong relationships that have been building over the course of the days and the weeks since the election. So for maybe for the narrative of trying to divide Republicans between them, that might help. I believe that the president wouldn't know that message would be sent.
And you're still supportive of the speaker.
Not only am I still supportive of the speaker, the entire, and many members of the Freedom Caucus just voted for him a couple of months ago. In order to become the Speaker of the House, you have to get the votes on the floor. Right. And what we just saw was it was almost a unanimous vote just a couple months ago.
Can I just ask, you were in the House as well for many years. What's your take on this? And do you think that the Speaker can still stay in his job and move forward?
Yeah, I mean, I go back to, Paul Ryan is still learning. And he tried something different. He tried to do a strategy that had not been tried, in my opinion, successfully before, and he failed at it. But that doesn't mean that he isn't going to learn from that. And it's always better in the House to start with your base. That's just the bottom line.
Do you think he learned that lesson?
I hope you learned that lesson. You always start with your strength and then you build from there.
Hold that thought. Sorry, we have to take a quick break. We have to pay your bills, Bakari.
I got you.
After the break, Republicans and Democrats get into a public battle about undisclosed intelligence. Can Congress be trusted to conduct a nonpartisan investigation? That's next.
U.S. Congress, so I have
The FBI, as part of our counterintelligence mission, is investigating the Russian government's efforts to interfere in the 2016 presidential election. And that includes investigating the nature of any links between individuals associated with the Trump campaign and the Russian government, and whether there was any coordination between the campaign and Russia's efforts.
That was a bombshell announcement from the FBI Director James Comey. And on Friday, we learned that former Trump campaign chair Paul Manafort and former advisors Roger Stone and Carter Page said that they would speak to the House Intelligence Committee about the Russia controversies. And we're back now with the panel. Congressman Zeldin, I want to start with you. As a Republican, do you think, in all fairness, that the American people had a right to know before they went to the polls that this investigation of the Trump campaign had been underway for months?
Well, the investigation that was taking place was with regards to there were successful hacks into the Democratic Congressional Campaign Committee, Democratic National Committee, John Podesta's emails.
The FBI director said explicitly that it was the Trump camp, any possible connection with the Trump campaign in Russia.
Right, but I'm just saying the focus of the reason for the investigation, the focus of that investigation was determining those hacks and whether or not, as you're trying to protect the integrity of Election Day itself and not being able to hack into our systems and State Board of Elections, like that was the purpose for what was going on, and that was the focus of it. Incidentally, as you are progressing and you start learning more of the facts, the investigation evolves.
Can I help the congressman?
Go for it.
The answer to the question is yes. The American people deserve to know that there was an investigation going on prior to the election.
Did you support Comey's letter 11 days before the election?
Oh, I did not support Comey's
letter. Okay, so you just contradicted yourself.
I did not contradict myself. Okay. But what's good for the goose is good for the gander. And so the fact is, if you want to come out and say that I've been investigating Anthony Weiner and we found these emails on a computer and we're going to go and investigate these emails, that's fine. But the American public also needs to know, because you've said here, Rick Santorum said here, Sarah Huckabee Sanders, Kellyanne Conway, and all have touted this line. You should not vote for someone who's under FBI investigation. Well, what do we find out? That the President of the United States currently is under FBI investigation. Take it for what you want.
What was he under investigation for?
He and his associates and his campaign for collusion with the Russian government in this presidential election.
We don't know.
First off,
there's no evidence of that. And number two, Dan,
with
all due respect,
yes.
Comey was not clear as to when the investigation about Trump's potential collusion began. I think what Lee is saying is that it started out not as an investigation of Trump or any potential collusion. We don't know at what point that investigation turned, and he was not clear about that, and it could have been after the election.
I want to ask about something else related to this that happened. That was really remarkable on Capitol Hill today. Congressman Devin Nunes, who's the chairman of the House Intelligence Committee, he had to apologize to Democrats and some of his fellow Republicans for sharing surveillance information with the White House and the public before he did so with members of his own Intelligence Committee. Listen to what John McCain said about that.
I'm calling for the Select Committee or a special committee. No longer does the Congress have credibility to handle this alone, and I don't say that lightly.
He says it lightly all the time, so that doesn't surprise me that John McCain.
Well, what do you think?
I think it should be done by the committees in charge. Do I think Devin Nunes made a good call? No, I don't think he made a good call. I think he should have talked to his committee before he went to the president, and I don't think his responsibility is to the president. And so, but I would say on the other side, Adam Schiff has reminded me of Joe McCarthy. I mean, these rants about all these coincidences of that have, if you string together, obviously show that there's a Russian conspiracy here with the Trump campaign, are absurd on its face, and he is being just as partisan as Devin Nunes is.
I don't think it's partisan when you've got an FBI director saying that there's clearly been Russian interference somehow in our election. We need to have the facts, and Senator McCain is absolutely right. I do believe we need to have an independent commission. I think that what happened last week shows that it's impossible for there not to be political interference in the Intelligence Committee's conducting this investigation. We're in two partisan environment, and when you're talking about a foreign government like Russia trying to interfere in our election cycles and Lord knows what else, we need an independent investigation.
Congresswoman, did your colleague Adam Schiff go too far when he said this week that the Trump-Russia evidence is more than circumstantial?
I don't think that he did. I don't have the information he does because he's not allowed to share it with me. Mm-hmm. But I think he is one of the most steadfast, even men that I know, and he would never say anything that didn't have truth to it. I admire the way that he's conducting this
investigation. No one else has said that there's any evidence.
White House to try to protect
no one else has said that.
And if Devin Nunes was coming out publicly with evidence and allegations to make the president look bad, then the Democrats would be celebrating. You don't have to come to the committee first. If you want to go to the cameras and say anything negative at all with regards to the president.
But do you wish that as chairman of the Intelligence Committee, which historically has been bipartisan, the last vestige of bipartisanship in Washington, should he have?
I agree with everything that Rick just said. He's absolutely right in his analysis. I just want to point out, though,
real quick,
that how this would have actually played out if Devin was going out with something that makes the president look bad.
Okay, fair enough. Thank you all for that great
credibility of that committee, period.
We'll leave it there. Thank you, everybody. Appreciate it. And